Take six of the great stately homes of Ireland and the families that live in them. Fold in three of our best chefs, Derry Clark, Catherine Fulvio and Paul Flynn. Add a pinch of history, a splash of opulence and a soupçon or two of hard work. Give the pot a good stir, bring to the boil frequently and then sit back and watch what happens. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the recipe for Lourdes and Ladles. On tonight's show, we visit the majestic Burr Castle in County Offaly, home of Brendan Parsons, the 7th Earl of Ross, and his wife Alison. The Parsons family have been here for almost 400 years, which is pretty impressive, but not nearly as impressive as the contributions to science and technology the family has made along the way. Contributions that have, in very different ways, changed the world we live in. The 3rd Earl built the famous Burr Castle telescope in the 1840s. Which remained the biggest telescope in the world for over 70 years. His son Charles invented the steam turbine, which, we'll put it this way, about 90% of the electricity generated in America is still produced using steam turbines. But we're here primarily to create a meal using recipes from a handwritten 17th century cookbook. Tonight's feast includes such showstoppers as peas porridge, a grand salad for the vegetable conscious, and roast rabbit with a pudding in its belly. One of the centerpieces is a potato pie from a recipe dating back to the 1660s. Bear in mind that the potato itself had only arrived in Ireland some 80 years earlier. But we're jumping the gun ever so slightly. Before we land in Burr Castle, our chefs need to decide on the division of labour. It's time to take the long walk down the long hall and lift the cloches of destiny. It's a simple procedure, really. Three chefs, Catherine, Paul, and Derry, and three cloches. Under each cloche, there's either a ladle, a token, or a carrot.
One, two, three.
Whoever gets the ladle assumes the role of head chef, responsible for cooking and presenting the feast. The ladle bearer is in charge, in theory.
I'm cooking.
You're the boss.
I say he's a tough chef.
Whoever gets the carrot has to roll up his or her sleeves and go find the ingredients for the feast, and then assist the ladle bearer in preparing the meal.
Here's what I've got to do. I've got to skin a rabbit. I have to gut a pheasant.
Oh, yeah.
I have to hunt hedgehogs and bluets.
Those bluets, they're all over the place. What's a bluet?
And whoever gets the token will be tasked with sifting through the archives and teasing out some of the history of the houses and of the families that live in them. And at the end of the day, this chef will take a seat at the table when the feast is served up.
The famine and the earliest potato recipe.
We're going back in time here.
Astronomy and photography.
Okay, this is old, but I have no idea how old. Marrow pudding and olio. What's an olio? Baked pheasant.
Okay.
Potato pies.
Pheasant is good, yeah? Yeah.
That's good. Spinach tart, no problem.
Yeah,
Jumballs. I like them already. They're my friend. You guys have it easy. I've got the tough one.
So holding the ladle and therefore the reins for our Burr Castle adventure is Master Chef Paul Flynn. Paul and his wife Maura own the tannery, restaurant, townhouse and cookery school in Dungarvan. Paul's reputation is based on serving modern Irish food, simply prepared, but with exciting tastes. So pig's heads and cow's eyeballs tend not to appear on the menu that often.
This is a menu from the 17th century, and we have to recreate this in Burr Castle, which is a huge challenge, like a bisque, an olio, marrow pudding.
The recipes are absolute. Wow. Sweetbreads, lamb stones, cock's combs, and eyes and lips.
We have to be reasonably faithful to this menu, but equally, it has to be edible. It has
to be.
They're not going to eat that.
You know.
So I don't know, am I going to cook it? If they're not going to eat it, I'm not going to cook it. That's for sure.
So Paul is head chef for our feast in Burr Castle, ruling the kitchen with a rod of iron. The role of gatherer, rounding up the ingredients for Paul, will be played by Catherine Fulvio, while Derry Clark takes on the role of diner. He'll share the feast with the rest of the dinner party and root around a bit to find out some of the history of the castle and the family. And he drives the others, which is nice.
I have eyes, lips, heads and everything to go cooking.
I'm going shooting, yeah.
Good luck.
See you, Paul.
See you, Paul.
Thank you. beautiful dining room in Burr Castle is upstairs. The kitchen where Paul will be cooking tonight's meal is downstairs. The archetypical architecture of the big house. Over time, the kitchens moved upstairs as the economics of maintaining the staff needed to service that upstairs-downstairs lifestyle proved too costly. In the kitchen today is an old friend of Paul's, Helen Manning, who, as well as being a fine cook in her own right, is also a bit of an expert on the aga. And Burr Castle has a very big aga.
Thanks for coming to help me.
Well, I don't know. I think I might just leave right now. Thank you very much.
Don't blame you. This is fairly gory. Here.
Yeah, it is. Eyeballs. Lovely.
Lovely.
Yeah. Lips, tongue. We've got gammon, sausage, eggs. And this would have been made into an olio stew.
Look, the whole point about these recipes, if we're faithful to them, will people eat them? Will they enjoy them? We want people to enjoy them. And I think we have to do some adaptation because of that.
But get a hint of what would have been.
Yeah, we got to stay reasonably faithful. But okay. I do think we got to make it edible and absolutely a spectacle at the end of the day.
Right.
But what's worrying me...
I think it'll be a spectacle, all right.
I'm not using it.
With those?
That's, honestly. No. You're a mad woman.
Looking at you.
You're a mad woman, I swear to God.
So those eyeballs will not be appearing in tonight's olio, nor will the cock's combs or the lips. Ingredients still in include beef tongue, neck of mutton, gammon and sausages.
Sweetbreads.
Yeah, we have.
Have we got the sweetbreads,
cooked
chicken.
The olio is never to be confused with the bisque, which requires shin and knuckle of beef, ox cheeks, bacon and sweetbreads. That's a lot of animal parts, and remembering what goes where is testing Paul's memory.
Something about parsnips in this, is there? Oh, there is, look. It's served on oysters, holy. There's oysters in this. 24 oysters floured and fried in butter.
When do they go in, though?
Right at the end, that's preparation.
So you don't have to worry about that just for the
moment? No. Give me a rub, I'm getting stressed out. Small rub.
But there's only so much Paul and Helen can do without the right ingredients. And making sure the right ingredients show up in the kitchen is down to the efforts of our gatherer for the day, Catherine Fulvio. Paul!
So do you actually eat pheasant yourself?
Oh, we do, yeah. Seamus loves his menus. I'm more just into the casserole dish and maybe a rash on top and some spices and away it goes.
I'll be telling Paul Flynn that now, because he's to cook it later.
I know, well, I love it.
The majestic pheasant was introduced into Ireland sometime around 1580. Initially, the pheasant's role in the ecosystem was mostly decorative. The fact that they're kind of, well, yummy, was almost a secondary consideration. By the 1800s, shooting had become a popular sport for gentlemen, and the pheasant was selected as a popular target. To both create and meet demand, the gamekeepers of big estates started hand-rearing pheasants in very large numbers. These days, the role of the estates has largely been taken on by game farms and gun clubs. Like the gun club that the two Seamuses run down here in Burr.
And how many pheasant would you breed here? How many would you have?
We have about 5,000.
5,000, yeah.
We decided to buy a plucking machine, which kind of simplified everything. Like, the demand for the birds that we shoot is increased every year. And in fact, at the end of the season, there's still people looking for birds.
So friends and family and local people would enjoy it?
Yeah, they've become very popular, you see, because they're chilled and they're oven ready.
Yeah.
And people will experiment, and when they experiment, then they like the taste.
Yeah. Do you know, there's two things I've picked up on in that conversation. Seamus has a plucking machine, which gets me out of one job.
Yeah. That can be done.
That's the
yeah.
first thing. Yeah, and the second thing, he mentioned oven ready.
Yeah.
Happy days! Happy days!